I really think it's funny. I crack myself up sometimes when I'm doing my sermon preparation. So I hope you find some of this funny. But I also want to make some serious points. So I'm going to start with one. Well, you'll judge for yourself. One of the things that I think I may do someday, like I started working on one book and it's turned into three. You know, none of which are anywhere near done, but be that as it may. Well, that's not quite true. But one book that I think I might like to do someday. Did any of you ever read The Gospel According to Peanuts a long time ago? It's really quite good. Charles Schulz was a committed Christian, and a lot of what he did in his cartoons, his Charlie Brown cartoons, had a lot of Christian overtones to it. And one of the books that was done was The Gospel According to Peanuts, and specifically how the gospel was deliberately inserted into some of the cartoons. Well, I'm not nearly a Charles Schulz, that's for sure, but I'd like someday maybe to write The Gospel According to Lorne. And what it's going to do is it's going to fill in the blanks. You know, because I think there's a lot of blanks in the Bible. You know, when the angel said to Mary, "Hail, thou who art highly favored." I use the traditional language because otherwise, then you've got it. When you're an angel, you got to use the traditional language. So, "Hail, thou who art highly favored. Thou hast found favor with God. Therefore, at age 13 or 14, you are about to discover that you are pregnant." Now, I don't know about your understanding of God, but if someday I wake up in the middle of the night, because at age 58, you often wake up in the middle of the night, any 58-year-old will tell you that, and standing at the foot of my bed is a messenger of the Lord, first I will question, which drug did I take before going to bed tonight to help my MS? But assuming that that's all clear, I will wonder, why is there an angel at the foot of my bed? And if the angel said to me, "Hi, Lord, hail, thou who art highly favored," I am pulling the blanket over my head. I do not want to know what's coming next. Because in Mary's culture, just about the last thing you can do, you know, as a young teenage girl is discover yourself to be with a child. Didn't I say that discreetly because there are kids in the room? You know, throughout my ministry, I have had to, that sounds wrong, it's not really me, so I've been involved in many pastoral situations, not dozens, but probably about a dozen, with the teenagers who just happen to discover that they're pregnant, or think that they may be pregnant. I've got to tell you this one, and I hope I'm not going beyond appropriate lines here. One of my youth group members one time was talking about a party that she had with her friends, and this was great. She was telling me this because she was so happy with the outcome of the party. She called it the pee party. And what it was about was a couple of her girlfriends and her had been really concerned about whether it was going to be one line or two line. You all understand, right? One line or two line on the little window and the little stick. Okay. And so what they decided to do one day at lunchtime at school was go into the women's laboratory and all the friends would have a pee party. And it was a celebration of the right number of lines for all but one of them. Anyway, this particular youth member, she was happy because it turned out she was not pregnant. But I never heard of a pee party before, and I don't know how common they are. But it just sort of tells you. I don't think there was any angel in the laboratory with them saying, "Hail thou who art highly favored, who have found favor with God and man." Found favor with man part, I get. Found favor with, I don't think so. Another story, just for the fun of it, one time I was talking to a parent. Now, you know this thing about PTSD? It's a big thing. Parents have been experiencing PTSD ever since children were invented. Okay? And sometimes, I've met with parents, and they look like they are in shock, because probably they are. Sometimes I felt like asking parents, "Should you be driving?" You know, because of what's going on. Anyway, this particular day I got a phone call from a mother. She had been doing, you know, her motherly chores, which involved changing the sheets on the bed, and had a teenage daughter. Daughter's 15 or 16, I think. One of those. Changing sheets on the bed. And she decided to rotate the mattress. You ever flip your mattress? you should every 6 months. That's what they say.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, right. So she went to flip the mattress and found a used pregnancy test between the mattress and the box spring. And so when the daughter got home, you know, the conversation was going to be something like, and I said, okay, here's what she's going to tell you. She will say she was just keeping it for a friend, you know, and every bone in your body will scream, let it go, let it go, let it go, because you don't want to know what you don't want to know, but you've got to ask more questions, you have more conversation than that. We talked you through. These are just some of the things. So you will, please forgive me when I say that when I hear the story of the Annunciation, that's what it's called when the angel talks to Mary, and then Mary goes and talks to her relatives, you'll forgive me if I think there's gotta be more to the story. There's gotta be more to the story, particularly in her culture. Like, just imagine it and be a parent for a second. It'd be Mary's mother or father or whatever, and your daughter comes to you, and let's see, you're having lunch, so you're sitting around the table, and there's your soup, and your little falafels, because, well, you're Jewish, and your little whatever else, and, you know, you're going to do carrots and hummus or whatever. And your daughter says, oh, guess what? I had a visit last night. You had a visit last night? Yeah. Oh, don't worry, go on, chill. Like, that's a good Hebrew word, right? Chill. You know, this Mary would be, well, she wouldn't be speaking Aramaic, but anyway, chill. If she was Anglican, she would have said, oh, chill, for God's sake. That's what she would have done if she was Anglican. She wasn't. Don't worry, it wasn't Joseph's evening window. It was an angel. Yeah, you've heard that tape, eh, Walter? Right, an angel. And, of course, because they're loving parents, they would have wanted to indulge her. So they would have said, oh, that's interesting, dear. Like, your kid came to you, your daughter, your teenage daughter came to you and said, I had a visit from an angel last night. Of course you would say, that's interesting, dear. What did the angel have to say? You know, you would say that before or after calling 911, right? So what did the angel have to say? Oh, it's kind of exciting. The angel said that Mary, have found favor with God. Really? That is lovely, dear. You know, we know you have been, you know, studying the Torah. We know that you've had your bat mitzvah. You know, everything's fine. Yet, it doesn't surprise us one little bit that you have found favor with God. And then mom and dad would be looking at each other and doing hand signs under the table. Like, where are you going to God? And what else did the angel say? Oh, that's the best part. I have found favor with God, and so the Holy Spirit is going to come upon me, and I'm going to be pregnant. Okay. Where do you go with that? Like, where would you go? Like, I sort of think, and I got to say this, for those of you who will ask after the service, where is Ben? Is he sick? No, he's not. And he's away for the weekend up in Tremblant at a cottage with friends of his, which is absolutely lovely. I can't believe I have some old enough to do that. Let's say Ben came home from school one day, and he said, oh, Dad, my girlfriend, you know my girlfriend? Yeah. Oh, she's pregnant. Don't worry, it's the Holy Spirit. Can you imagine what it would have been like? But then Mary, she would have had to tell her parents. You know, she wasn't married, so where would she be living? You know, she's not living in an apartment alone. You know, she's living with her parents. Or at least a first degree relative. Okay? But parents. And then she goes around and tells other people. Can you imagine what it would have been like to go and talk to Joseph? This is another part of the story that I'd like to write. Joe! Great news! 8 months from now, you're going to be a daddy! And Joseph, because he's a man, he'd be thick. He'd be going, What do you mean? Because he's a man, right? He'd need her to draw a picture. Well, Joseph, an angel came to visit me and said, Hail Mary. And we're not talking about a football passing, Hail Mary. We're talking about Hail Mary. We're talking about the Mary and the Hail. Hail Mary. You found favor with God, and so you're going to get pregnant by the Holy Spirit. How do you tell that to your fiancé? Like in our culture, that's one thing. You know, like we don't have any rules anymore. We have forms, okay? Our society has reduced morality to forms. And by that I mean, for example, their declaration of live birth when a baby is born. There doesn't need to be an attestation of the male parent. We've reduced relationships to legal convenience, but that was not the case in Mary's time. She was doing something that was going to get her at least in very serious trouble. So how do you say that? Let's say, like, how would she have set that up? Like, would she have sprung it on him? Just laid it on him? Or would she have sort of tried to finesse it a bit? I have this fantasy where she invited him over for supper, because after all, they were betrothed, right? Which is as good as marrying, except they haven't had a ceremony. They were betrothed. And so I have this image that she invited him over, or she invited herself over to his place while he was making chairs or something. And she set the table, put a little vase of flowers in the middle, and made a special meal, and then said, Joseph, I got something to tell you. You made that chair, so it was a very solid chair, so sit down, you're going to need it. What would you have said? How would you have done it? And you know, that's one story. That's the story that we're using leading into Christmas. But how many times in the New Testament, let alone the Old Testament, did God do something that was really weird according to the social norms of the time? Like, he really didn't behave himself at all. And I gotta tell you, it is no wonder that when Jesus began his public ministry 30-odd years later, the people who he had the biggest problem with were the religious people. Because so many of the things that he said and did, just the circumstances of his birth, were so contrary to the values of the day. Let's say, and I don't want to get weird on this part, and I don't want to be sarcastic on this part or facetious or anything, but I need to personalize it somewhat in terms of our congregation in order to make it real. Suppose one of the lovely teenage women that we have in this congregation, their tummies started to rise, and everybody was discreet because that's what we are. I learned a long time ago you never ask a woman if she's pregnant. But people are looking, and as time goes by, she's putting on a little bit of weight, it seems, and then at a certain point, it comes. You know, there's some things to talk about, at least directly, at least at the beginning. But then people, not with malice, not with ill will, began to say, So there's a bit of a buzz. And because we're all, Christian, there'd be no trashing. It would just be a comment. And there'd be a test. There'd be a test for each of us. If such did happen. Oh, and by the way, it has, but you just didn't know. It would be, what's our responsibility? What's our role as a Christian community when one of our own shows up in these type of circumstances? There are congregations which would pick her up. We wouldn't do that. We wouldn't do that. We'd probably have a baby shower. But at the same time, whoa, this is strange. One of the lines that somebody would say, not out loud, and not in public, because we just don't not do that, because we're nice. But to somebody, she didn't seem the type for that job. What type are we talking about here? The human type? Is that what we're talking about? But every conversation, And we want support. Unlike a time when Mary got pregnant, we would not take a hole in the front lawn and put a sticker in it and throw rocks there. We want support. We want to make sure she's taken care of. And it would, I don't need to overstress that. That's what we do. But then imagine this person then was to come to us and say, yes, I am going to have a baby, but don't worry, because this baby didn't come about in the normal way. This baby, it's the Holy Spirit of God, has caused this baby to come into being. So this baby that I'm going to have is going to be the Savior of the world. And I'm not being silly here, I'm not being facetious. You know, it's not ridiculous. The baby is going to be the Savior of the world. I really think we would be nonplussed. How do you respond? You still want to support. You still want to be there. You still want to do the right thing. But for whatever reason, maybe it's because of your parents' reaction. Maybe it's just the stress of the thing. Maybe it's the way your parents are treating you. Maybe it's just because she's so anxious inside. And she's gone. Like, what else can you say? What more ridiculous thing? What more ridiculous thing? And some of us, because we're religious, we'd start doing theology. And let's pretend that this is the first time this has happened, that a young girl got pregnant to save the world. Obviously, I'm making a parallel, that's not. God doesn't do that. That's not how God tells us sexuality is supposed to be expressed, and he's never done that before. And so you've got a teenage girl claiming to be pregnant by the Holy Spirit with the Savior of the world. You're not going to believe it. You're not going to believe it. I don't believe you believe it. And I think the fact that she maintained that would slowly cause some people to change their mind. And I think that for some, the support will begin to turn to perhaps not judgment, certainly not at first, but concern and worry. And then we've got to do something for her that will help her deal with reality. Because you know what? God just doesn't get teenagers pregnant, does he? He doesn't do that. We would get to that point. And no matter how much faith we have, no matter how much belief we have in God, in his transcendence, and his ability to do wonders and miracles, what we do, we put God in a box. And we say, God, we know you're sovereign, we know you're the Lord, but behave. All this stuff about being nice people and holy people and kind people and caring people and sharing people and helping others and caring for others, we like that part. But God, behave. Don't do anything too wild, too crazy, too outside the box. I hate that phrase, outside the box. The only people I know who use the phrase outside the box are people so in the box, it's unbelievable. But then maybe after going through that process of doubt and disbelief, and could this be happening in our community? Could this be happening to us? Could this be happening to her? Maybe we start doing some reflection. And we think of the shepherds. You know, like there's an image of the shepherds. The shepherds are sort of wimpy people. You know, they follow the lambs around, man. You know, they're like they're croziers and all the rest of it, and their long robes which don't have any stains on them and all the rest of that. That's what shepherds from Jesus' time. Shepherds of Jesus' time were strong, aggressive people. They had to protect. You know what the chief threat to the sheep was? Robbers. Thieves. The shepherds could be attacked by robbers who wanted to steal the sheep and run off the sheep for their own reasons. So shepherds were armed. They carried weapons. Sometimes with snakes and rocks, because of the Roman rules about weapons. Sometimes with a stick. But they were there to protect the sheep from animals and from humans too. These guys were rugged. They had muscles. You know, they weren't wusses. Can you imagine these guys sitting out watching their flocks? They were watching their flocks. They weren't having a nap. They weren't having a curvy. They were watching their flocks. All of a sudden, an angel from heaven appears to them, soon to be followed by a multitude of the heavenly host. That's a part of the Bible that we read too. And they say, go and see that which is born for you in the city of David, a Savior who is Christ the Lord. By the way, it's that girl Mary. Remember her, she lives down the block from you. Oh, Mary! Oh yeah, we all thought we knew Mary. And now she's had a baby? Yeah, she's had a baby. Oh, cool. Don't worry, the baby's the Savior of the world. Next morning at breakfast, guy comes home. He's been on the night shift of shepherds, because that's the way it worked, eh? People would pool their resources and their talent and their sheep, and they'd take shifts. So he's returned from his night shift, and he's sitting down for breakfast. Who knows what breakfast is? How was your night, dear? A bit unusual. Yeah, you got in really late. Oh yeah, well, we were sitting in the field and an angel appeared. It's strange. You know, there's a line that's not in the Bible, but I think it should be. And I think it should be in the Bible almost as frequently as the word God. And it's this. You're not going to believe it. You're not going to believe it. Abraham goes home to Sarah. Go to a land that I'm going to show you, says God to Abraham. Can you tell me now? No. Pack up all your stuff. Start walking. And I'll let you know a little bit of the time on the way. Well, Sarai, says Abraham, you're not going to believe. But a little while later, Sarai goes to Abraham. Sarai, well past years of childbearing. And she's childless. She goes to Abraham. Abraham, you're not going to believe this, but I'm pregnant. Take it down the road. Take it to the prophets. Name the Shunem, you know, this guy who had leprosy. And he's told, go and speak to this prophet. The prophet doesn't say anything about healing salve or lifting up prayer or do cartwheels and gymnastics while praising God. Just go wash in the river. We got better rivers than that in our own place. No, wash three times. And he comes up, and this army general, okay, like this, like imagine Bruce Willis in one of his bad movies after he's been beaten up. That's probably the way this general looked. All of a sudden, he comes from out of the Jordan River, and his skin is described as being like a baby's skin. This will not have stood him in good stead with his men. What happened to you? I took a bath in the Jordan. You're right, we don't believe it. And then you go further and further and further. You know, it is the nature of God to do the unexpected in an unexpected way, in an unexpected place, at an unexpected time. All through the Bible. And even when you look at Jesus and his life and his death, you could say, you're not going to believe it so many times. Whether it's what he is doing or whether you're on the receiving end of it. The man born blind, Jesus, spits, makes mud, slaps it on his eyes. The guy, you're not going to believe it when he tells his friends how he got back his sight. The guy who gets it just goes on and on and on. There's something about the nature of the way God works that leads you to say, no, you're not going to believe it. You're not going to believe it. But the only way you can believe it is when you look at what happens as a result. The event defies comprehension. The follow-up explains why it's true. And no matter what you think about Mary, and probably not a lot of you have done a whole lot thinking about Mary, that's okay. No matter what you think about Mary, no matter what you think about Joseph, no matter what you think about their choices, no matter what you think about their cousins like Elizabeth and John the Baptist, no matter what you think about the whole stage here, you cannot deny even if not from a spiritual point of view, just from a purely practical point of view, that the baby that Mary gave birth to changed the world. There's absolutely no way you can deny that. Whether you see him just as a human baby who was born into the world, whether you see him as somebody that was born into the world and then spent his time in with a seeing community where he received religious instruction and then went off as a prophet or a rabbi or whatever, you cannot deny the effect of this guy's ministry. You cannot deny the effect of what this person did. Even people who were hostile to the message, like, for example, Josephus, who was not a believer, gives testimony to who this person, well, what this person did. Hostile sources. You cannot deny that whatever it was that caused Mary to be pregnant, that caused Jesus to be born, used that as a way of transforming the world. And the fact that we're sitting here this morning, and the fact that we are hearing the kids in the background, and the fact that we continue to baptize and confirm and receive communion, and the fact that we'll be back here, I hope, on Christmas Eve to celebrate this birth, gives testimony to the fact that however much it defies our comprehension, something outside of the normal things happen around this time about 2,000 years ago. The question we have to answer for ourselves is a personal question. What impact are you going to let that have on your life? Because I got to tell you, if you're one of the ones who receives the story, let's say from a shepherd, you're not going to believe what happened last night while I was watching the sheep. Let's say from Elizabeth, you're not going to believe, as old as I am, I'm about to have a baby. Well, John the Baptist, by the way. Or from a 14-year-old girl. You're not going to believe, but I'm pregnant, and it's God. It's God that did it. Whatever you make of that, it has to be an internal decision and realization. It's going to change your life. You can't live the same way anymore after going, and what if it's true? Each of us is called by the stories to make a decision as to where we stand in relation to them. Is it just made-up tales to justify flawed human behavior? Or is it actually true? If it's true, it means everything. That means the salvation process, the salvation purpose that God had when he caused this stuff to happen continues even to this day. And you know what? Maybe, because God works in the lives of ordinary people, someday, somehow, in some way, you'll be in a position where you will say about something that happens in your life, you're never going to believe it, but let me tell you what God has done to you. Now let's pray. God, in the midst of our ordinary lives, sometimes very extraordinary things happen. Usually when we think of that, something extraordinary, we think extraordinary, not good. Like a car crash, or losing a job, or end of a relationship, or we think extraordinary in terms of, but you are the God of the good extraordinary. And looking at those stories, it really does defy belief some of the time. So we claim faith as a gift from you, and grace as a gift from you. And we open ourselves to that still false small voice within that would give testimony to the truth. God, in this season, there's going to be lots of people doing lots of Christmassy things that really have very little to do with faith. But I would pray that in your church, faith would grow, and that would change lives, would change our lives. And that our lives would witness to your love and the truth of the message. God, I pray for our service here on Christmas Eve and on Christmas Day. that for at least some of them, it will be a new way of seeing you. And that you're not going to believe this would turn into, you know what? Yeah, I do. In Jesus' name.